Welcome to St. Mark United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Bob Marks, and it's my joy to greet those of you who are in the sanctuary this day, as well as those of you who gather us with us online. Church picnic is scheduled directly following this worship service in Fellowship Hall. Come and join us and have a time in which we share fellowship and fun, as well as some good music together. Directly following the worship service. The Fight Hunger with the 100. The collection has gone very well. We are over the numbers in terms of each of the group that we asked you to bring. Thank you for your generosity. Trenton Area Soup Kitchen will be gathering, our group will be gathering for July the 3rd. For more information, see Bill Wiesack. Our summer camps are started. You could pick up registrations in the narthex for theater camp, July 8th through 12th, choir camp 2, August 19th through 23. Scuba VBS will be held on July the 22nd through the 26th. We are in need of some items for Vacation Bible School, so as you leave today, take a look at the net and the little fish that are in that net. Bring in those items for the kitchen of VBS. The St. Market Fair has been scheduled for October the 26th. Plan to be part of that. You can get information from the midweek as to all the things involved in the craft show. Having gathered these announcements, we now prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We invite you to join in our call to worship. The God who answers in a day of trouble is among us. The light who lights a candle during the night is here.
And let's stand for our hymn of praise, number 116 in your red hymnal, and on the screen, the God of Abraham praise.
Thank you. You may be seated. We enter into a period of prayer together, beginning with the unison prayer of confession. Trusting you does not always come easy when each day we are faced with the ugliness of the world. We do not believe that love conquers fear. We are not convinced that power comes through weakness. Forgive our lack of faith, O God, and renew our trust in you, disciples of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Because of such great mercy, God is ready to forgive all the ways we fail to live faithfulness. Relying on the mercy, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Now we join together in that prayer which Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture lesson for today is taken from Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 to 14. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham?" And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, "Father?" And he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." This is the word of the Lord. Please rise if you are able and sing hymn number 123, found in the red hymnal and up on the screen. And we will sing it through twice.
Today we have some friends with us. When we hunt for the hungry, that's to support the Pearson Memorial United Methodist Church and their food pantry. I was told that they were going to be here, the cooking hours here. No? Well, again, we're thankful for the partnership we have with Pearson Memorial. Now, this person I know saw coming in and I think gets the award for having come the farthest to worship this day. And that is Michael. Michael Pfeffer, will you please stand? Again, we give God thanks for your presence here this day. A number of years ago, I preached a sermon series on things I wish Jesus had not said. While our Old Testament lesson did not come from the mouth of Christ, it is qualified as a text of terror. In a day of religious extremism, it is a dangerous text, which on the surface seems to condone the ancient practice of child sacrifice and smacks of child neglect, if not child abuse. While we cannot ignore this text, we must look carefully for the message of grace. Early in the scripture, we are told that this is a test for Abraham. Those of you who've completed school over the past weeks have successfully navigated finals. You know that a test is to measure whether you have mastered a body of material. If you pass, it is assumed that you are ready to move on to the next unit, the next lesson, the next grade. If this is a test, does Abraham pass by taking Isaac up to the mountaintop? Or does Abraham fail by taking the boy up to the mountaintop? Is it okay for us at times to say no to God? And are there times when God wants us to say no? Have we not learned from Nuremberg and My Lai that simply claiming that we are just following orders is not sufficient excuse for committing atrocities? On the surface, God seems to be demanding the sacrifice of the son of promise, the child of Abraham's old age, Sarah's only child. God tells to Abraham to go and make a burnt offering. And Abraham follows instructions, puts his trust in God, and in the end, God provides the ram for sacrifice. The problem here is that we don't recognize the God portrayed in this passage, a God who demands more than we could possibly surrender. This wild, untamed God looks nothing like the nice, kind, gracious God who we middle-class, respectable, middle-of-the-road Methodists come to worship for 1 hour at worship each Sunday, and always and only 1 hour. Maybe we stay a moment for coffee hour, and on certain days we might stay for the church picnic, but no more. Our faith is a comfortable one, and God never pushes us beyond our country zone. Or does God? God understands, or God does, or does to God. Growth edges as people of faith include finding a few moments each day being in for prayer, being decent to your neighbor, maybe writing a check to a charity. Little wonder we do not recognize the God in this story who is no one's gentle uncle or remove loving grandparent. Give it up, God says to Abraham. Take what you love the most, what you care the most about, what you've tied up your hopes in, and then turn it all of it loose. Everything was riding on those last good years. We'd be set to retire, to travel, the good life. Then she got sick. We were set. We had worked hard. We raised our kids. Then the kids lost their jobs, their home, and there was nothing to do but to let them come back. After 20 years, that so-and-so left us with one parent and three teenagers. There was a pink slip after all those years. Take what you love the most, what you care about, that which you've tied up your hopes in, and give it up. Let it go. Despite our wanting to recoil from this haunting story, we know something about sacrifice, don't we? I mean, we sacrifice every day for our children, our spouse. We make sacrifices for our employers, for the Little League or the Rotary, the PTA or Scouts. Time does not allow us to talk about the systems in which folks make sacrifices for this church. This week we will celebrate the thousands of persons who have fought or lobbied to support the freedoms we enjoy as a nation. Sacrifice is built into anything that really matters to us. But Abraham's willingness to sacrifice that which was nearest and dearest, as unfathomable as that may be, is only one aspect of the story. Whenever we look at Scripture, it's never primarily about us and what we do. It's about God and what God does. God invites Abraham to consider the unthinkable in order to witness the unimaginable. Only as he is willing to let go does Abraham witness to that which God can do. I call your attention in this passage to three times a statement is made about God and about God's provision. First, as they're going up the mountain, Isaac points out that they have forgotten an essential element for the sacrifice. Abraham responds, God himself will provide a lamb. After interceding on Isaac's behalf, Abraham names the place Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. Our scripture ends with the statement, as it's said in this day, on the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. One of the names the Hebrew people used to refer to God is Jehovah Jireh, translated both the God who sees and the God who provides. Abraham discovers here that the one who is the giver can be trusted with the gift. God needs to know whether Abraham is willing to let loose of that which is most precious to him, trusting God who gave him that gift in the first place. This is not the last time that Abraham's belief in Jehovah Jireh is challenged. As we turn from Genesis 22 to Genesis 23, we encounter the death of Sarah. Sometimes we do not let loose of that which is most precious to us. It's grabbed from us. Still, we are left with the challenge. Do we trust the one who gave us the gift in the first place? Do we believe that when there's nothing else that we can do, that there is a God who provides? Even and maybe especially in the most desperate moments of our lives. All of us have faced circumstances which have pondered why things have happened and how and where God is present in those circumstances. Someone whom we love dies terribly, unexpectedly, too young. We find ourselves facing a difficult situation or decision. We lose a job and cannot find another. Our health fails and our spirit goes with it. A relationship is broken and we can't mend it. Our marriage falls apart and we can't put it together again. Daily tasks overwhelm us. The future before us is uncertain and not what we planned. Jehovah Jireh, are we willing to trust the giver of life, even when life's good gifts are in jeopardy? Abraham trusted that God would provide long before he saw the ram in the thicket. Before he knew how or when, he knew God would provide. Can you honestly say with me today, Jehovah Jireh? Today, we celebrate a service of healing prayer. We invite you to come forward with your questions, your challenges, your concerns, and your pain. Bring all these things in your life that you need to let go of. Those situations that cause you terror and keep you up at night. Dare to believe that when you reach the end of your rope, we serve a God who provides and can be trusted with your life and those things that are most important in your life. Jehovah Jireh, let us trust a God who provides, while not always a way out, always a way through. Amen.
It has been some time since we've had a time of service for healing prayer. We simply invite you, if you wish, to come down to share your concern with me, and we ask you to keep it brief so that other persons can assist. You come down, I hear your concern, I anoint you with oil and pray for you. There's nothing special about the oil, it's common olive oil. There's certainly nothing special about the one who lays his hands on you other than my care for you and my love for you. So again, the organist will play something for us. We invite you to come down and to experience the healing touch of Christ. Now our ushers will wait upon us for our morning offering. Almighty God, you have given these gifts to us from the first. Receive them as we offer them back unto you for the work of Jesus Christ in this world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And please remain standing for our closing hymn, number 130 in your red hymnals, and also on the screen, God Will Take Care of You.
Thank you.
Jehovah Jireh, dare you believe that God will provide. Go with the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.